Jonah Wesley, and Adam Bellhues is off the top step, and the manager for Burlington comes out on the field to make a pitching change. Jonah Wesley allows 3 runs, 3 walks, Bandits leading 7-0 with 2 down in the bottom of the 6th, and runners at 1st and 3rd. This call to the bullpen is brought to you by Jorgensen Insurance. Jorgensen Insurance is composed of insurance professionals who offer high-quality auto, home, life, and health insurance from 18 major carriers. If you have a need for Jorgensen Insurance services, give them a call at 563-355-9777 or toll-free at 800-324-9703. Bandits by 7, threatening for more. New righty to tell you about after this break on the Bandits Broadcast Network.
Of the top young players in every organization. Want to see them in action? Buy tickets online anytime or watch more than 5,000 games live and on demand on MILB.TV on your computer or iOS device. Participate in fan contests and listen to the Show Before the Show podcast to hear from newsmakers around the minors. MILB.com. Follow the stars of tomorrow today.
Want to rep the best minor league team in baseball but aren't at Martin Woodman Park? The River Bandits team store is online at riverbandits.com, and fans can have all the merchandise from the top brands like Nike, Under Armour, 47 Brand, Retro Brand, and New Era delivered straight to their front door. The River Bandits store stocks a wide variety of t-shirts, sweatshirts, outerwear, and headwear featuring all the River Bandits logos. Stop by Martin Woodman Park or visit riverbandits.com and get your gear today.
Hi, this is Carson Rue, right-handed pitcher for your Quad City River Bandits, and you're tuned into River Bandits Baseball on Real Country 1170 KBOG.
Well, if there's one guy that's been the stopper this year for Burlington out of the bullpen, it's Jackson Zarabin, and they need to stop a nosebleed right now. 3 runs in the bottom of the 6th inning. Jonah Wesley walked 3 batters, allowed 3 runs. And he doesn't finish his first inning of work. Now, Zarabin into the game, and he's coming off his first shaky outing in a while. July 30th against Beloit, he allowed 2 runs over 3 innings, and that snapped a streak of 8 straight outings for Zarabin in which he did not allow a run. So he's kind of been the Salvador Montaño, Devin Carr mix for the Bandits, putting together a bunch of scoreless innings as of late. He's 6-1 with a 2.13 ERA. 28th outing for Zarabin, and he inherits runners at 1st and 3rd with 2 away. Bottom of the 6th, Bandits up 7, and Abraham Toro Hernandez at the dish. And the pitch. Fastball is low. It's 1-0. And now Navarro wants to go out and talk with Zarabin. Zarabin from Sonoma State, 24 years old, so again, a little bit older for the Midwest League. But signed as a free agent last summer. Middle of June, they picked him up. So he went undrafted out of Sonoma State. Pitched in Orem last year, now here in the Midwest League. He's been impressive. But he's behind in the count, 1-0. And here's the next pitch. Her ball sinks outside. It's 2-0. On Abraham Toro Hernandez. Yeah, we were chatting a little bit about Torrey Hunter Jr. there before the break and how he's quickly becoming one of the more intriguing prospects. Jordan Adell, now named the number one prospect in the Angels system, over Jamai Jones. 2-0 is a cutting fastball in the inside corner. 2-1. Jordan Adell, just 18 years old, a Louisville, Kentucky product. He played at Ballard High School. You talk about a guy that could go to the NFL. Jordan, or Joe Adell, as he goes by short. Freakishly athletic. Here's the 2-1. Fastball inside. It's 3-1. And we certainly won't see him. It's very rare to see 18-year-old high school kid that just got drafted in full season ball. He's down in the Arizona League right now. Could maybe touch Orem by the end of the year. Yeah, they're very high on him. Three balls, one strike to Toro Hernandez. The pitch. Swinging a line drive, sinking toward left field. McDonald can't get it. Skids all the way to the wall. Dawson scores. Seiber right behind him rounds third. And Toro Hernandez is into second with two more runs driven in for the Bandits. RBIs number 7 and 8 in the Quad Cities uniform. Both those runs charged to Jonah Wesley. But it's now 9-0 Quad Cities in this interminable bottom of the sixth inning. Well done to go to the opposite field for the left-hander Toro Hernandez. And as Cameron comes to the plate, he's the ninth Bandit due up here in the sixth. Zarabin set, and the pitch. Curveball low and outside. It's 1-0. Gets away slightly from Navarro, but sweeps it up and runs it back out to Zarabin. So yeah, looking at some of these outfield prospects that the Angels have put together at the lower levels. Look at Troy Montgomery, who was a teammate at Ohio State of Ronnie Dawson. He was promoted from Burlington earlier this year. And Burlington, with their lackluster record, 46-63, they've had some guys that catch your eye, but it seems like a lot of those guys that have been promoted up to Advanced A haven't really been able to get things going all at the same time. So here's the 1-0. Swinging a foul back. It's 1-1. Troy Montgomery. Troy Seiber, the Bandit's first baseman, but Troy Montgomery was the first to go up to Inland Empire. And then Brennan Lund kind of became that catalyst at the top for Burlington. Of course, once things started moving in the right direction for him, he was promoted. Then it became Jordan Zimmerman's team, really. And now he's gone. 1-1. Swinging a high chopper toward third, swept up by the third baseman McCann, and he flings on to first to finally retire the... We welcome you back to Davenport, Iowa. Hope you enjoyed the stretch. We go to the bottom of the seventh inning. The Bandits leading 9-0. But still great theater for entertainment here on the Bandit Broadcast Network. Midwest League President Dick Nussbaum back with us for the bottom of this seventh with the Bandits up 9-0. And Dick makes his tour all around the Midwest League throughout the season and gets to as many places as we can. And off the air, we were just talking about your opportunity in Kane County to go hang out with Hawk Harrelson.
Yeah, that was exciting.
Who has a better on-air voice, you or Hawk?
I don't think I'm in the same universe as Hawk.
I don't think Hawk's in the same universe as Hawk.
I remember when he played for the Red Sox and the Indians. And I enjoyed watching him play baseball. He's pretty exciting on the field as he is in the booth.
We go to the bottom of the seventh. First pitch to Josh Rojas is swung on and grounded to second. Bobbled by Juan Moreno. He recovers and throws past the first base bag. And that kicks off the railing. Safe at first is Rojas. And they're going to assess an error to Juan Moreno out at second base. And the Bandits get their leadoff man aboard here in the seventh. That's the third B's error today.
You know, what's getting lost in all this is that the pitching staff here for Quad Cities has only given up one hit.
And it came way back in the first inning. It was an infield single.
Yeah.
Back in the first, despite a diving effort by Osvaldo Duarte. Since then, nothing. Just a couple of walks and... Yeah, as we cross here into the 9 o'clock hour in the Midwest, it's been all Bandits tonight in this series finale. And I know you're a big fan of competition, but Quad City's on the verge of going 12-1 against the Bees in the 2017 season. But nonetheless, Community Field, when's the last time you were over there?
I was there for Ed Larson night, so that was a few years ago. So it's been a while since that. I was there for their hot stove a year ago. So I've been back to Burlington, but this will be the first time for a game in a while.
First pitch was Valdo Duarte slips through the zone for a called strike. He walked and scored in the sixth, has also struck out a couple of times. But obviously you probably get to more South Bend Cubs games than any.
I get to a lot of South Bend Cubs games, yeah.
It's a beautiful ballpark. I had my first chance to go a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, they've done a great job in renovating it.
The 0-1 pitch comes home.
Swing and a miss, and that's a park that kind of similar to this one where it's older, but they had a huge renovation project that really brought it from a classic feel to a modern feel, and that's one of the cool things about minor league baseball and some of the smaller markets, an opportunity to take a throwback old field. This one's been around since the 1930s and turn them into something that feels real modern and fancy.
Yeah, South Bend's is not nearly as old as this one. This is really a classic. It was built in 87. It was really one of the first modern minor league stadiums with the berms and the covered concourses and things like that.
The 0-2 pitch is a called strike three on the outside corner. Duarte down on strikes for the third time today. As he gets the punch out, Jackson Zarabin back on the mound. He had to come in to clean up the mess for Jonah Wesley last inning, who gave up five runs in just two-thirds of an inning of work. But of all the upgrades and renovations, this is probably one of the best places to see a game. Look at those LED lights that we put in this year, and you can look straight at them. Hardly looks like they're on, but they're cascading some good light down. Yeah, did you notice those when you walked in the ballpark?
I did, because I knew that they were that you were going to those, and that's really important. The major leagues like that.
The first pitch to Ray Henderson is a called strike. Now, obviously, that doesn't bring us quite as much entertainment as the Ferris wheel down the left field line. Have you been on that thing yet?
Not yet.
We got to get you on there for at least one ride around.
I think so. Andrew said he'd get me on there.
Oh, okay, good. So as soon as you're done with me, you get to have the real fun.
Yeah.
And go ride around on that Ferris wheel.
I've been on Ferris wheels.
I've been on it once. Yeah. 105 feet in the air. It's higher than you think.
Yeah.
9-0 Bandits lead, bottom of the seventh inning. Zarabin's pitch home to Henderson is popped foul first base side. Midwest League president Dick Nussbaum here on the broadcast with us, and that's 2 years in a row now that when you've joined us, we had a Mediacom TV game going on next door. And
they didn't let me on last year.
No. Well, that's because last year we were down on the concourse.
Yeah,
they were afraid,
right.
They were afraid your grandson would run in and mess with all their fancy equipment.
Yeah.
Here we're very relaxed. You're allowed in whenever you want.
I appreciate that, Chuck. I love doing this. I really do.
Well, you know, we have the MILB TV app.
Right.
It's available right in front of you here and available online. And I think it's a really awesome thing that minor league baseball's gotten involved in. Of course, there's MLB TV.
Yeah.
But still the chance for parents, families, and fans of these players and teams all across the country to get in and check things out.
And it's good for me, too. I watch a lot of games on MILB TV.
You probably got, what, four different computers going at one time with different games, monitoring and everything?
Drive my family nuts.
We got to get you your own Red Zone channel.
Yeah. And it also provides an opportunity when there's on-field issues that I have to sort out. You know, I can do it right away.
Well, hopefully you don't have to do anything live and in person here today.
I don't think so.
Probably not in a 9-0 game.
Yeah.
The 1-2 home to Henderson. Popped up first base side, foul territory. Sinking quickly, it'll land in the dugout over on the first base side. Now the Lake County Captains are one home run away from matching their single season mark as a team. The Bandits are one home run away from matching their single season mark as a team for history. What's with all the uptick in home runs? What you got going on in this league?
I think there's really good players this year. You know, you look across the board. You know, we had Bichette and Guerrero for a while, and it's Jody Adams that's with the Loons, who had three home runs the other night. There's some really good players in our league this year.
Still a ball and two strikes on Henderson. And after this next pitch from Zarabin, that'll lead me right into my next question perfectly. The 1-2 pitch comes home, and Ray tops it up the third baseline, but it's foul. It hit off the plate. Now, we've kind of seen two different things. You mentioned Bo Bichette, the teenagers, with Vladimir Guerrero Jr. in Lansing. But then you've also got an older team in West Michigan. You have a little bit of an older team here in Burlington. This league, as a Class A league, you would imagine settle right around that 20-year mark. But to me, it seems like that's changing. I don't know if that same classic mode of guys get drafted, the next year they come to A-ball, then they go to AA. Have you seen that, too, across the board?
You know, West Michigan has traditionally been an older club, and I just think that's the Tigers, you know, mindset. You know, there's just a lot of young players in our league, a lot of young Latin players. We had Eloy Jimenez in South Bend and Gleyber Torres, who unfortunately got hurt. Both of those have figured in big-time trades for the Cubs, you know. Chapman last year and Quintana this year. I think Jimenez is a great pickup for the White Sox.
Yeah, he got some pretty big loud from a lot of the people in this league as the 1-2 runs in, hits Henderson. And that'll put him on base as the runner Rojas goes to second. Henderson aboard on the hit-by-pitch. Second time he's been on today, a walk and now a hit-by-pitch. Runners at first and second with one out here in the bottom of the seventh. Bandits leading 9-0. Midwest League President Dick Nussbaum on the air with us in this bottom of the seventh with the Bandits looking for a sweep. But, yeah, the Cubs making a couple of big trades. You know, Dylan Cease, who was with South Bend, he was actually supposed to pitch against the River Bandits our first night in town, and then all of a sudden he gets scratched from his start late. Nobody knows why, and sure enough, it's because of a crazy trade going over to the White Sox.
And I was really surprised at that because he was a good, he's a very, very good pitcher. And, you know, it's not like the Cubs have a lot of pitching
depth in their farm system. They got a lot of high praise for Cease, and of course, Eloy Jimenez, who just continues to knock out light poles wherever he goes. First pitch to Luis Piano is a called strike on the lower outside edge.
Nice young man, too.
Hey, you get a chance to meet, I'm sure, a lot of the guys in the league in general, but especially those South Bend Cubs. Now, are you a Cubs fan at the major league level?
No, I grew up in Pittsburgh, so I'm a Pirates fan. So okay. I'm a little safe in the league because I don't have any teams that I really root for.
Sure, can't play any favorites.
Yeah.
Is the 0-1 pitch.
I did go to the World Series in Chicago last year.
Well, there you go. So you were
I was rooting for the Cubs last year in the World Series.
Well, if you're going to Chicago, you better root for the Cubs. Yeah. Otherwise, you might not make it back.
Yeah.
This area turned into Cubs country pretty good.
Did it?
Once the Cubs made their playoff run. Of course, we're right in the middle of everything. You got the Royals a few hours away, the Cardinals a few hours away, the Cubs a few hours away. It's the beauty of the Midwest, right?
Absolutely. And you can listen to all those games on the radio.
Or you can listen to the River Bandits.
That's right. That's the one you should listen to.
Exactly. Listen to the president. 1-1. Here's the pitch to Piano. That's down and away for ball two.
But as a little boy growing up in Pittsburgh, we didn't have the streaming broadcast and all that. But
no, so you had the transistor radio
the
underneath
transistor
your pillow?
Radio sneaking in my bedroom, and I would go around the dial and listen to 1120 KMOX, and 1020 was the Pirates, and 10:30, I think, was the Boston Red Sox, WBZ.
They made it all the way out to Pittsburgh, huh?
Yeah, they were all 50,000 watt, you know, late enough at night they did.
The 2-1 pitch chopped foul down the third baseline. Now, who was your favorite Pirate growing up when you were watching?
Roberto Clemente by far, yeah.
I was going to assume it, but I didn't want to, so I had to let you say it.
Yeah. There were a lot of really good players that I saw. He was the best. And it's a shame that, you know, the younger baseball fans don't really know much about him because he was just the best.
Yeah, ESPN did a nice 30 for 30 on him to try to highlight his storied career. As the 2-2 pitch comes home, fastball misses outside 3-2, and of course had the tragic abrupt ending.
Right.
But nonetheless, he did just as much for Latin players, paving the way for them to join Major League Baseball as Jackie Robinson did for African Americans.
Yeah,
so
there's a lot of Latin players that say that. He's the Jackie Robinson for, you know, the Latin players. And he was, you know, he was, even in Pittsburgh, there wasn't a lot of warm and fuzzies for some of his outspokenness.
The 3-2 pitch skied in the air to shallow left center field. This is a tough play. In comes McDonald, out goes Rivas. And it'll be the shortstop Rivas who backs up to make the catch. And there is out number two in this bottom of the seventh inning. Piano retired for the second time tonight, now 2-for-4. One of the newcomers to this Bandit team, and a ton of turnover for these River Bandits and for these Bees. You know, Quad Cities has 6 guys from their opening day roster still on the team. Burlington only has 7.
See, you guys know more about that stuff than I do.
You have to see all the transactions. Yeah. I send them to you.
No, I do. I look at those, but, you know, I can't pay attention to them as much as I should, you know, to that extent, to know that there's only 6 from the. But, you know, that's the facts of life here at this level. There's really good players, and they get taken and moved up.
Yeah, you root for guys to do well, but not too well.
Yeah.
The first pitch to Chaz McCormick. He's batting in the stead of Ronnie Dawson after coming in as a defensive replacement. The first pitch skips past the catcher Navarro to the backstop. Wild pitch will advance the runners. Rojas to third. Henderson to second. 9-0 River Bandits in the bottom of the seventh. 9 runs on 9 hits for Quad Cities. Helped along by a couple of walks, a couple of errors as well. Burlington's made 3 of them, including 1 in this inning. That got Rojas aboard to start the frame.
You know, you mentioned you send those transactions every day. That's another thing we do really well. You know,
communicate
and keep track of what's going on.
Well, I feel like I talk to you almost every day.
Well, you do, in a way.
Well, we appreciate you and Holly staying on top of all that and keeping us clean and good to go as the 1-0 pitch gets the called strike.
You got to give Holly most of the credit there.
Sorry, we appreciate Holly and you doing everything you can to keep us ship shape and everything under control and the playoffs coming up.
Yeah. That, you mentioned the first half. You know, I get the calls. You know, what are the tiebreakers?
Yeah.
You know?
That was me reaching out because it was down to the wire.
Yeah.
The 1-1 comes home.
But you're not the only one.
Oh, I believe it.
You know, that's one of the things that, you know, we don't get all the games in. You know, it's never going to happen. So,
outdoor sport spans, what, 5 months out of the year? Kind of hard to expect every single game to be played.
Yeah. And when you split the season up, you just can't make up some of the games.
Right. Well, it's kind of a weird schedule this year for Quad Cities, too. They played Clinton back-to-back weekends in April and didn't see him again until June. It was a 2-1 pitch. Slapped into right field, falling down the line. That's a base hit. In to score is Rojas. Coming around Henderson as well. McCormick is at second, digging for third. The relay throw from the shortstop, Rivas, is held. It's a two-run triple for Chaz McCormick. And the Bandits lead it 11 to nothing.
He's a great piece of hitting. And he's a lot faster than I give him credit for.
2017 draft pick, a D2 guy. And we talk a lot about the Latin guys, and of course you have the big lauded picks. But I feel like in this league, we've also seen a lot of those Division II, Division III, junior college, NAIA guys. As Connor, my broadcast partner, and I were talking about this the other day, that the cool thing about baseball is if you just keep playing, you got a shot.
Yeah.
Chaz McCormick, who was a four-year player at Division II Millersville, their team went to a national championship in 2016. Came up just shy to Nova Southeastern, one of the premier D2 schools down in Florida.
You know, it's amazing the scouting programs major league teams have to pick up somebody like that.
Unbelievable, isn't it? The reach that they have and the ability to get to all those games. And then, of course, here during our games, TrackMan, all the video surveillance they've got going on, they analyze everything down to the rotation on a guy's curveball during games in real time. It's nuts. The Bandits actually added a fourth coach this year, Jason Bell, the development coach, whose primary duty is to understand and infer all that data. Believe it or not, it's time-consuming.
I'm sure it is.
Here's Chucky Robinson, runner at third base with two outs. First pitch swung on and missed, a breaking ball. And it's nothing in one. And as Dick pointed out earlier this inning, just one hit for Burlington. That came way back in the first inning compared to 10 for Quad Cities and an 11-0 lead for the River Bandits, scoring two more in this frame. They broke it open with a 5-run sixth, but now add more here in the seventh just for good measure.
Well, no flooding this year. I was really happy to see that.
Not here, as the 0-1 pitch is chopped foul third base side. Clinton did have a little bit of an issue. We lost one game in there last week. A little bit of flooding in their concourse area. But luckily, that all got rectified. Played a doubleheader the next day. But yeah, we've had the flood walls go up a couple of times. And I know back in the day, those flood walls went in a few years ago. And before that, every time that water crested, everyone was holding their breath. There are those awesome, depending on who you ask, awesome pictures of
the island
of Davenport and modern Woodman Park. That's right. The 0-2 to Robinson. Check swing on the appeal. No, he did not. That's ball one. And Robinson, kind of the exemplary player of this league. He started the season with Quad Cities. He was behind Jake Rogers, who's a top 10 prospect in the Astros organization as a catcher. Rogers went up May 15th after the game in Dayton, and then right after that, Robinson took off. He had a 32-game on-base streak snapped a couple of days ago, which just continues to impress. Not quite what Jose Siri did this year. As the 1-2 comes home. Fastball on the outside corner. A called strike three. Robinson down on strikes for the third time today.
That's an 11-0 call.
Manager for your Quad City River Bandits, and you're tuned into River Bandits Baseball on Real Country 1170 KBOX.
Welcome back to Modern Woodman Park. We go to the bottom of the eighth inning. The Bandits all of a sudden lead trim to 7. 11-4, Quad Cities trails. 11 runs on 10 hits for the Bandits. 4 runs on 4 hits for the Bees, plus an error in the eighth inning for Quad Cities. So they go to the home side. The Bandits will look for some more added insurance before the 9. Heart of the order due up for Quad Cities. Troy Seibert to lead things off. He's drawn a couple of walks, scored a run, and driven one in with a sacrifice fly. He got the scoring started tonight way back in the first inning. Jackson Zarabin back to work, and his first pitch is a fastball on the inner half for a called strike one. Peoria now up 12-3 on Beloit. So the Chiefs with a late rally looking like their pull away for Quad Cities and help the Bandits out. That would give the Bandits a game and a half lead over the Snappers before the two clubs begin their four-game series tomorrow. The 0-1 pitch breaks in low. One ball and one strike. And we got some good pitching on tap this week. Starts tomorrow. Ronel Blanco gets the ball for Quad Cities. He's got a 3.60 ERA. Takes on Matt Milburn, who's got a 3.90 ERA. And the next 2 days feature four starting pitchers that all have ERAs under three. The big one is on Monday. As the 1-1 comes home to Troy Seiber, and it's bounced towards second. Moreno on three skids, collects, and throws out Cyber for out number one. Monday night features Carson LaRue, a Midwest League All-Star for the River Bandits, who's 11-4 with a 2.83 ERA, against lefty Zach Irwin, who has dominated the Bandits a couple of times this year already. And the southpaw is 5-2 with a 1.68 earned run average. The pitcher's duel expected on Monday. That's the third game of this four-game series coming up after the Bandits finish up things with Burlington. 3 outs away from a series sweep. Here's Abraham Toro Hernandez. First pitch home, swing and a miss. That's strike one. But the Bandits will send Blanco in game one, Abdiel Saldana in game two. Told you about LaRue, and then they finish it up with Christian Javier, who looked really good yesterday. Just 2 runs across 6 innings. The 0-1 slapped back up the middle, of base hit. Second hit of the night for Abraham Toro Hernandez. A one-out single. And how about the eighth inning for Peoria to pull away? 10 runs on 11 hits. They sent 15 batters to the plate. Had 4 doubles and 2 triples. That recap brought to you by Nathan Baliba, the voice of the Peoria Chiefs on the road at Pullman Field right now. And after watching 2 losses, including a tough one yesterday in which Peoria blew a healthy 6-2 lead, wound up losing 7-6 in extras on getaway night at Pullman Field. The Chiefs get one good last hurrah in. Staz Cameron digs in next. First pitch, fastball up, 1-0. So the Astros' 9-run fourth inning tonight, not the most scored in a single inning across baseball this evening. Peoria edging them by a run. The Bandits had a 5-run sixth, helping them to their 11-4 lead this evening. Jackson Zarabin peering in, gets his sign, and comes ready with his 1-0 to Daz. Here's the pitch. Breaking ball, hammered in the air to right center. Coming in, Jonah Todd, and the center fielder coasts underneath it to make the catch for out number two. Toro Hernandez retreats back to first. Cameron now 1-for-5 today after singling in his first at bat. That did extend his hitting streak to 4 games, but he's gone hitless since. And with 2 outs and the runner at first, it'll be up to Josh Rojas to try to extend this inning. And what's likely the last plate appearance for Quad Cities tonight, barring a big rally from Burlington in the top of the ninth. They'll have their 6, 7, and 8-hole hitters due up against more than likely Carlos Sanabria. Haven't seen any warming for the Bandits in the bullpen. First pitch home, the breaker on the outer half, a called strike one to Rojas. He reached on an error his last time up. He's also singled twice in the game and struck out. Here's the 0-1 pitch to Rojas. The bender misses down and away. 1 ball and 1 strike. Now, usually in a heavy offensive game like this, you'd imagine that the player of the game would come from the batting order. It's going to be hard to take it away from Johan Ramirez today, who didn't allow a hit in 4 innings. The 1-1 pitch. Tipped foul off the end of the bat. A ball and two strikes on Rojas. Ramirez will get the win today if the Bandits hold on. Four innings, no hits, no runs, three walks, four strikeouts. And a win would make him 3-4 on the year. Now it's up to the official scorer's discretion as to who was most effective because the starting pitcher didn't go five innings. But I think it's a pretty easy comparison between Ramirez and Sanabria's lines, with all four runs scoring in the eighth charged to Sanabria. Here's the 1-2 to Rojas. Breaking ball skied over the infield towards the second base bag. The second baseman Moreno coasts underneath it, makes the catch still on the infield dirt, and that will end the inning. Bandits get a one-out single from Abraham Toro Hernandez, rather, but he is stranded and the Bandits do not score. We go to the ninth, last chance for Burlington with the Bees trailing 11-4 to the Bandits on the Bandit Baseball Network.